Welcome to George Mason University's Studio A. My name is Rick Davis, and today our guest is Thomas Kaufman, a director of photography and an author. Tom Kaufman, welcome to Studio A. Thanks for being here.
Thank you. Thanks.
I want to take you back to the very beginning. Tell us how you got interested in film.
Well, I was about 4 years old, and my father had taken me to visit my grandparents in Florida, and there was an ice cream parlor there, and they had a Nickelodeon at the ice cream parlor. And I'd never seen a Nickelodeon before. This is, I guess, around 1960. And my father picked me up and said, look through that hood. And he dropped in a nickel and he turned the crank and I saw Charlie Chaplin in a short, silent short. And there was something really magical about that. And from that moment on, I was really interested in Charlie Chaplin. And by the time I was 8, I think I'd seen all of his films. And right around the same time, rooting through our attic, I found an old wind-up 8mm movie camera that my father had gotten during the Second World War, and it had fallen into disuse, and I asked him, could I use it? And he said, hell no. No, he said yes. He said, please, go ahead. So I went to the drugstore and got some film and loaded it up, and I started shooting with this film camera. You know, exposure, frame rate, what was that? I had no idea. I was just having fun with the camera. And then when I finished the roll of film, I thought it was like a tape recorder, so I swapped it out with the take-up reel, and I re-exposed it all again, going the other direction. So it was all superimposed, and half of it was going backwards. And that was my first film.
You were making avant-garde films before your time.
Much before my time. But I haven't gotten much better since then. That's the problem.
So you obviously developed a professional interest was that in school or later on?
It was during school, but not in school. Mm-hmm. I mean, I would shoot stuff over the weekend. I was interested in single-frame animation and doing tricks. Mm-hmm. You know, I didn't know about Georges Méliès back then, but I was sort of obsessed with the idea of magic and film and trying to do magic tricks using film and cutting it, you know, really obvious, stupid, clunky effects now. But, you know, at the time I was doing it, I thought, wow, this is really great.
So when did you sort of say, I'm a cinematographer and that's what I'm going to pursue
professionally? Oh, well, that was a long time later, actually. There are a lot of photographers in my family, and my mom knows a lot about still photography. Mm-hmm. So she helped me set up a darkroom, and I was doing a lot of still photography up to a certain point. And then when I got into high school and junior high school, I was getting more interested in film, and I took a filmmaking class one summer, and I really started to get more interested in cinematography at that point. So probably like my junior and senior years in high school.
Do you think there's a relationship between learning still photography well and then translating that into making films?
Yeah, because the aesthetics of a frame would be the same. It's, you know, it's of course much more complicated when the frame is moving and the actors are moving or the players are moving and the camera is moving. But, you know, understanding composition is something that you can learn from seeing a still frame or from looking at an oil painting in a museum, for instance.
Was there anything that sort of launched you into the business? Was there one of those breaks or pivotal moments or?
Well, I did have a break in the sense that the film class that I took when I was in junior high school, I kept hold of the guy's name that taught that class. And then when I was back over the summer, I'd had my first freshman year of school in California, and I came back to Ohio for the summer. And I called him up, and I said, hey, I don't think you remember me. He says, oh, no, I remember you. And I said, well, I'm studying film now, and I would love to work with you. And they were doing commercials. So I started to be a production assistant on their commercials over the summer. So it was that in. I didn't know anyone in the film business, you know, in Ohio, but my teacher remembered me, so that was a lucky thing.
Well, there's kind of a lesson there in terms of never throw out a contact.
Right? Be nice to your teachers.
Even a better lesson. So your title now, among others, is Director of Photography, or DP for short. What does that mean? What all is wrapped up in being a DP?
Well, there are different terms for it in different countries. In England, they would call you a lighting cameraman. And I think that says it very well, is that in addition to your duties as a camera operator, you're also responsible for lighting. So that you might have someone working with you in your crew, you might have a gaffer and a grip and a bunch of people working with you, but the look of it falls on your shoulders, and you usually would discuss that with the director before you implement whatever plan it is that you're going to do. So a director of photography is kind of the same thing. You are responsible for not just operating the camera, but the look of it. Mm-hmm. Now, sometimes on some union shoots, the director of photography can't operate the camera. He's required to have a camera operator. And sometimes the producers will say, well, we want the director of photography to operate the cameras. And the union will say, well, you have to have an operator. So they'll hire someone and they'll call him a ghost operator, which I thought was just a great name, a ghost operator.
Ghost operator. Where's the ghost?
And, right. And so the ghost operator doesn't lift a finger. Yeah, he or she gets paid to sit there all day while the director of photography is operating the camera. And that way they satisfy their union requirement and they still get their aesthetic, whatever that happens.
Ever had one of those jobs?
Yeah. I was on The Wire and I was a ghost operator for, I think, 2 days. That was all I could take. I mean, some guys were on the set. Some guys were ghost operators for months on that show. And I just couldn't take it. It was very, very difficult to sit there and not do anything.
Highly paid intern, right?
Well, you know, not even. I mean, I think an intern would get more to do than I did. I don't know if you know Dave Inslee. He's a local director of photography who's was also DP on The Wire. And I said to him, Dave, I hope I get to operate one shot today. And he said, don't get your hopes up. Because the producers didn't want that.
Yeah.
The producers really wanted the DPs to do all the run operating. So,
What makes a good DP? What do you have to know and be able to do to succeed in that profession?
Well, I think two things would really be helpful. One is understanding the story that the director wants to tell. And that's whether you're making a fiction film or a commercial or a documentary. It's all about story. And story is something that as human beings is hardwired into us. And so the director of photography's job is first of all to understand what that story is going in. And in documentary, that's really important because in documentary, there's like, you know, you're making thousands of decisions. And if you don't know what's important and what isn't, you're in a really bad place to make those kinds of decisions. So that'd be the first thing. And the second thing is, ask yourself, what am I doing here? You know, the director of photography, what's the purpose of this job? And I think that the director of photography is there to help the director make their movie. But that's not always what you see happening on the set. Sometimes directors of photography have a different agenda. Sometimes they've become disillusioned with the director. Or they're interested in building shots for their reel. Or, you know, they're interested in something else that's tangential to the making of the film. And so that time then, I don't think they're providing a service like they could. So I think those are the two main things.
So the relationship and also an aesthetic.
Right. Well, they're intertwined because you're trying to help the director make their movie. Well, to do that, you would have to understand what it was that they were trying to do. And they'd have to be able to articulate it. Sometimes directors don't articulate things very well. In that case, you're kind of on your own. You know, you're kind of grasping for it. And sometimes you know, in documentaries, it doesn't come together till the edit, where, you know, what's this movie about?
Sure.
I mean, I've had that happen, too, where we're shooting all over the place. No one knows what the movie is about.
Actually, speaking of which, we have a wonderful clip, which we'll show in a second here. This is from the Ghana footage that you shot for a science documentary, if
I recall. Yeah, WGBH had a show called Science Odyssey, and it was about the 20th century and what's happened, what have we learned. And we were doing a show about medicine in the 20th century, and it took us to Ghana. And we filmed there for about 9 or 10 days, I think.
Wow. Well, we have a spectacular clip that I'd like to show, and then we'll talk a little bit about it.
Sure.
Let's watch.
All right.
Bring me a little water, Sylvie. Bring me a little water now. Bring me a little water, Sylvie. Every little once in a while. Don't you see me coming? Don't you see me now? Don't you see me coming every little once in a while? Bring me a little water, Sylvie. Bring me a little water now. Bring me a little water, Sylvie. Every little once in a while. Bring it in a bucket, Sylvie. Bring it in a bucket now. Bring it in a bucket, Sylvie, every little once in a while.
So that is obviously shot lots and lots and lots of footage to get those beautiful shots, and then you found music to go with it.
Sweet Honey and the Rock.
Sweet Honey and the Rock, which is a wonderful group here in the D.C. area.
Right.
Tell us about how you chose those shots, how you framed them, how you laid them together. What were you thinking about?
Well, you know, we're shooting this documentary, and this was about eradicating a kind of parasite from the face of the earth. And to do that, we were following a doctor from the CDC named Don Hopkins. And he went to Ghana, and we were following him, and he was going to village, explaining to people how they could filter their water mm-hmm. and keep these parasites out. So in the course of doing that, we're filming people taking water, going to get water from their village. And these people expend, you know, hundreds or thousands of calories a day just getting to where the water is and then taking it back. And if this water is infested with parasites, then it's kind of a bummer.
Yeah.
So 3M created a kind of fabric and just gave it for free. And these people could pour the water through this fabric and it would filter out the parasite and they could be free of it for the first time ever. So it's a pretty amazing thing. So they said, okay, so we'll start out really early in the morning and get people going, taking their water. But, you know, early morning doesn't necessarily look like early morning. So those first shots, I'm using a graduated filter to give that early morning kind of look. And then the other shots are just things that we're taking, you know, as we're getting closer and closer to the watering hole. Then we filmed a little demonstration with the doctor, and he's explaining how it works, and we're filming the local people, and they're listening, and all that stuff. And most of that is in the final film. Mm-hmm. But when I saw the final film, I saw a lot of footage that I thought was really nice stuff that they never used. And so I called WGBH and I said, could you send that to me? And they said, sure. So they sent me that. And then I took some of these shots that I liked so much.
Oh, how great.
Put them together, that piece of music.
Yeah, that really works beautifully as just as a piece of film. But now the story behind it's even more moving. We have another clip. We're going to go right to it because this is a whole other kind of thing. This is a setup. This is an interior. It's a time pressure situation you'll tell us about. And it just, the circumstances couldn't be more different, but it's just, it's equally beautiful. Let's watch.
You're seeing what the Nazis didn't want people to see.
So that's extraordinary footage of a whole different character. It's in a very tightly controlled environment. Tell us how you got that shot and what it was all about.
Well, they're actually two different parts of that mm-hmm. sequence. There's the opening sequence where someone's walking down a hallway and taking a box out of a drawer. And then there's the small plaster figures, which are shot on different days. The opening sequence, most of the film had been shot at that point. And I got a call from the producer on the West Coast saying, hey, look, can you just go and shoot an opening for me? And I just needed to be kind of dark and mysterious. And that was kind of the direction that I got. So I went with the sound recordist, and the two of us had about an hour to shoot that whole opening sequence. So before you see the plaster mm-hmm. things, those shots were all done in about the space of an hour. So we had to move pretty quickly. But one of the things that I've learned about story is that you get people interested in what you're doing, not by overloading them with information, but actually by withholding information. Yeah. So this is the opening of a show about a scrapbook that was recovered recently that had all these Nazi photographs in it. So by making you wait to see what it is she's got in this box, you're sort of creating interest in the part of the viewer as to what that might be. And then the plaster figures, those are usually enclosed in glass. That's a model of Auschwitz. Mm-hmm. And they took the glass off for us to film, but they wouldn't do it till after the museum closed, and we had to be out by 10 p.m. So we had basically 4 hours to set up a dolly track, get a boom arm, like a camera jib, and put a snorkel lens on the camera. So the camera's underslung on a jib, mm-hmm. going down to these figures that are about 3 inches tall.
Wow.
The adult figures, the baby figures are a lot smaller than that. And it's about 600 pounds of camera gear suspended above me.
Over these priceless,
over this artifact. Yeah, and I got the curator of the museum standing right behind me. And over here's the director wondering, how long is this shot going to take?
Yeah, wow. So, and how did you light that? Because the lighting is mobile in and of itself, and it really is part of the story.
Yeah, well, we used HMI lights focused through a lens and bounced into mirrors. When you're shooting something that close up, you have very minimal depth of field. So we had to have a lot of light. And one of the things I checked with the curator was, is it okay to put a lot of light on these plaster figures? Mm-hmm. And he said, yeah, that's not an issue. So, and then we would swing the mirrors or swing the lights to create movement. So we had the camera movement, and we also had the movement of the lights in the mirrors to create shadows moving.
Yeah. Now, you've shot, obviously, in many different kinds of environments. We've seen two. What are some of the challenges of working in just all these different locations that your career takes you to?
Well, you don't know what you're going to walk into at any given time. And you try to get as much information as you can going in, but sometimes mm-hmm. there isn't any. Sometimes you're asking the producer, you know, tell me more, and there isn't. They don't know anymore. So, you know, you just have to rely on your experience as to what you think is going to make the most sense and, you know, try to cover yourself.
In Ghana, for example, were there specific challenges just being, you know, away from your normal kit of resources and
yeah,
spending
you're,
all day in the field?
Well, you're you know, exactly next to nothing. So,
yeah, right.
You know, if you have an equipment problem or some mm-hmm. error that you made, you know, we're shooting film. So we went back and forth a lot. My producer wanted to shoot 50 ASA daylight balance film. And I said, let's go with the 200 ASA. He says, no, but it's so bright out. I said, yeah, but no one's going to be out there in the direct sunlight. Believe me, it's an equatorial country. People have any sensor in the shade when it's really bright out, and that's where I'm going to need the latitude. So we'd have talks like that. Mm-hmm. You know, there's some filtration. I would use low contrast filters sometimes if I was shooting a lot of like deeply shaded area, and you know, I didn't have a lot of contrast. I would put that in.
Just going back to the Ghana shot for a minute, you have water, you have sun, you have human, you know, subjects, mm-hmm. and then you have land, so many different textures and lots of different lighting situations even in that one shot. So,
right.
A good instinct to use a faster film.
Yeah.
Going back to something you raised earlier, because I want to tease this out a little bit more. Mm-hmm. Director of photography versus director. Have you ever been in the situation you described where maybe there was a different point of view on how something should look or even what the story would be? And how did you negotiate that? How did you resolve it?
Well, if they don't do it my way, I walk. You know, I just go back to my trailer. I have a cappuccino and I think about it.
Right.
It's their movie. You know, they're paying me. I'm not being paid to be a prima donna. I'm being paid to help them. So, you know, but it's definitely advise and consent. I mean, and a lot of times I'll say to the director, look, I'll make suggestions. I'm not offended at all if you don't like my suggestions. Mm-hmm. If you want me to stop making them, just let me know. But I feel part of what I'm supposed to do is make suggestions, and if they're helpful, that's great.
Yeah.
So, but I don't take any offense if, you know, because I also have to trust that the director knows what they're doing. And that, you know, if something in their instinct tells them that my suggestion is not going to work and what they're doing, then that's good enough for me. Now, you know, later on, I've had directors come back to me and say, hey, you know, you were right.
Yeah. But it's the collaborative process.
Yeah, but I'm sure, you know, just as many or more times, you know, the director was right because it was their movie and they had the vision. They knew what it was they wanted to do better than me.
Let's go to our students and see if they have any questions for you. Mm-hmm. Who has the first question? Yes.
Hi.
Hi.
My question for you is, who in the industry has inspired you?
Who has inspired me in the film industry? Well, when I was living in California, I met a lot of directors of photography. And I met Vilmos Zsigmond and Billy Williams and Conrad Hall, Bill Fraker, Laszlo Kovacs.
Mm-hmm.
And and they're at that time, they were like, you know, the very top. And they were all inspiring to me because they were all very kind. They weren't jealous people. They weren't, you know, stingy with the students that wanted to talk with them. You know, they were very open about, you know, what they were doing, and they're happy to explain. Like, if you said, hey, I saw you did this effect in this movie, and how did you do that? It wasn't a professional secret. They'd tell you. If they could remember what it was, they would tell you what they did. So I thought that was very inspiring to reach that level where you were considered to be world-class at what you're doing, but not so full of yourself that you couldn't talk to people and answer their questions.
Great. Do we have another question for Tom? Yes.
Yes. Will new technology change the role of a DP?
Yeah. That's a good question. I think that it will change, definitely, because simply by the fact that the technology is new. I mean, I've got this Sony F3 camera I'm playing with now, and I'm learning about it, you know. And, you know, if you take out a RED camera, you know, there's all this new kind of technology to learn. So in that sense, the DP's role will always be changing as technology evolves. But in the other sense of, you know, the aesthetic sense or what your job function is, I don't think that's going to change unless, you know, they hold a referendum and decide, hey, we're changing this. This is different now. It's not what it was. Yeah, but I think that'll stay the same regardless of how you film it.
Yeah. Anybody else have a question? Any other student questions for us?
I'll take a silly question.
Silly. Anybody have a silly question?
Yes.
Back there. Is this silly or? Okay. Oh, no. Well,
I was just opening it up.
Those, right.
Was there any particular project you felt like really invested in as the DP?
Oh,
good question.
Yeah, there have been a bunch. And the ones that I felt invested in were the ones where the director told me what they were doing. And, I mean, part of it was me just being interested in it. But also it was them. You know, sometimes I get directors who call me up and they'll say, hey, I want you for this number of days. Are you available? What's your rate? Fine, bye. And I don't really hear anything about what the project is. I mean, I might not know till the day I show up what it is I'm doing. And it might not be from lack of trying. I might send an email or two saying, hey, could you tell me what we're doing? Or send me an article, like you've got a magazine article or newspaper article that relates to the subject that you're filming, because I feel it helps me do my job better as a DP to understand what it is, what their topic is. There have been a number of shoots. I did a documentary about the homeless that Ginny Duran directed called Promises to Keep, and that, you know, that had a big impact on me. And I'm working on a film now about a school in the Berkshires called Indian Hill. And by the way, I want you all to visit my website if you feel like it. It's thomaskaufman.com. But there are a lot of clips there, and you also see a clip from Indian Hill. This is a film I started making in 2004. I really feel like I'm closing in on the deadline now. And it's about a school for the arts in the Berkshires. Very, very unusual school. And they had great teachers. And some of the students that came out of it are Frank Rich and Arlo Guthrie and Julie Taymor and Carly Simon.
Wow.
So, but also a lot of people that we never heard of who benefited from arts education, even though they decided not to go into the arts. And that's really what that story is about. So that's something I'm very...
You got to get that one made.
Yeah.
It's an important...
I'm working on that one.
That's great.
Very slow.
Terrific.
Yeah.
Anybody else before we turn it back to me? You've heard me ask questions. Yes, here's one down here.
Mm-hmm. Do you think in the industry we're going to switch, since it's all going digitally, do you think it's going to be more Arri Alexa-based or Redcam-based for now?
Oh, in terms of different cameras?
Yeah.
Well, I think that camera models will come and go, and today's Alexa will soon become, you know, tomorrow's Arri S. I mean, it's, you know, it's all going to change. The technology will keep evolving. And while it's important to keep in touch with that and be able to use it, it still leaves the aesthetic part of it virtually untouched. You know, you're still going to have the same considerations about framing, where the camera goes. This is like a major question. Where does the camera belong when you're shooting a scene? And it's interesting to watch different directors and how they reach that decision as to where it goes. And someone else was talking about, you know, or I guess we were all talking about camera and, you know, when you walk out of a movie, you don't, if you're the DP, you don't want someone walking out of the movie saying like, wow, that was a really well-photographed film. I didn't understand a thing anyone was saying in it, but great photography, no boom shadows. You know, I mean, the photography is just supposed to be part of it. And if people are coming out of it, you know, talking about the photography, then I feel maybe the DP made a mistake.
Good. Yeah. I have one sort of final question.
If it's the final question, all right.
This might be the final question. It has to do with the breadth of your career has taken you, obviously, through film, through television, through, you know, short subjects, through political commercials, through, you know, kind of what's your favorite? Where's your heart if it's in one place?
I love doing work that has to do with music. I mean, documentaries have to do with music are really a lot of fun for me because I like to play music just in my spare time. So I got to film and do an interview with Bella Fleck about 2 years ago, and that was
wonderful
really great.
Artist.
Yeah, and Edgar Meyer, who lives, it's a neighbor of his and lives in Nashville, so we filmed him the next day, and that was great. I was filming a documentary called, Be Not Afraid. It's one of my early documentaries, and I filmed a Shiloh Church Baptist Choir.
Wow.
And these guys were amazing, and I had a great time filming them. So anything to do with music, of course, is a lot of fun. But stuff that is, that's, you know, social action mm-hmm. stuff, stuff that, you know, you're filming something that might have a chance to help someone else, I think for me is particularly meaning stuff, you know, that I can really get into and, you know, do, try to give more if mm-hmm. I can, you know, to that kind of project.
Wonderful. Well, Thomas Kaufman, this has been a delight having you on Studio A
today.
I think we've learned a lot, and I should mention just in closing that you're also a prize-winning mystery author, but we don't have time to talk about that. But people can probably find out about that on your website, I'm guessing.
I hope so.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Tom,
for
being on Studio A.
Rick, thanks a lot.
This has been Studio A. This is our 50th episode, and we're celebrating. Rick Davis, thanks for watching.